Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our second webinar in our Digital Week series. Well, cybersecurity, that's not a topic that's exciting to many of us, so I'm very happy that we have that many viewers today. Just last week in Switzerland, there was a case where a medium-sized Swiss company just outside of St. Gallen went bankrupt because they couldn't deal with the fallout of a cyber attack last year. So this is a very important topic, and I'm very happy to have two renowned experts with me today who will discuss ways how you can prevent such situation from happening, and many other questions, of course, as well. So one of my guests is Sami Aliyev. He's program director of our Data Protection Officer program at the Executive School. And we also have Daniel Seiler with us today. He's joining from Bern, and he's the deputy head of the cyber office of the Swiss Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So welcome, Daniel. Maybe you can briefly turn on your camera, and welcome, Samia. For those of you who are really joining for the first time today, just two remarks. We will record the session and distribute the link to the recording and also to the slides next week. Also, we will discuss your questions after the presentation and the little interview with Daniel. And please send us your questions anytime by using the Q&A or F&A field in your Zoom program. You can also upvote the questions you find most relevant. And to discuss amongst each other, please use the chat. So
thank you very much, Friederike.
Thank you, Samia, for taking the time. Thank you, Daniel. And
hello. Thank you.
An insightful webinar.
Hello, everyone, and hello, Daniel from Bern.
Hi, Samia.
Right now, we are going to start this presentation, Daniel. Then you can stay online. Afterwards, we will start for interview. Let me start with our folios. So I hope you see now the presentation. Good. Today, our topic is cybersecurity in the age of digitalization. This is our agenda that we are first going to talk about the overview of the cyber risk landscape and cybersecurity in digital transformation period of the organizations. And then I will shortly introduce cybersecurity breaches and how to implement cybersecurity in your digital transformation period. After that, we will have interview with Daniel, as Friederike said, and Q&A session will be followed. So there is some questions I would like first to ask, if you can just answer yes or no. I think now you are going to see the questions. Please just answer all those three questions, yes and no, then we will continue our presentation. Just a couple of minutes. First question is about your digital transformation process. Is your company already on the way for digital transformation? Then are you using special device or IoT devices to generate more data than even before? Then are you using big data to analyze those data and drive your business success? Those are our three questions, and I see interesting answers. We have mainly yes, yes, yes. Good. And I hope you also see that the questions on your screen. I'm going to close the Q&A session. And then let's see how it goes. Welcome to the digitalization era. Once you have the digitalization process and you collect data more even than before and analyze it for your business success, then you are in digitalization process, digital transformation process. And also welcome to cyber risk area. While you start your digital process, in the same time you open new gates to cyber criminals and you increase your capability against the cyber risks. Before that, I'm going to share with you the first World Economic Forum's Global Risk Report for 2020. This is top 10 global risk for our global economy. As you see, cyber attacks and data fraud and theft is in number top 10 cyber risk in the world. That means a lot for the business, especially for the companies they are in at the moment in the digital transformation process. The organizations face wide range of risks. They can cause financial loss or reputational loss if they don't really implement cybersecurity or data security measures at the beginning of their process. This is our topic today. I'm going to discuss with you, and hopefully it will be helpful for your further development. So when we talk about cybersecurity risks, there are different kinds of risks, but the main risks are financial risk, which will cause a monetary loss if you lose the control of your company, your systems, network, and the data. Also, once you paid, you have also a reputational damage that you will go to the press, your company will go on the press, and you will lose the trust of your customers. In front of the customers, you will be weak or unsecure service provider, because all the digitalization process is for customer satisfaction, to give better service to our customers in the future. Then also there is a legal and compliance risks. Once you have any cyber attack, your customers can do group class actions against your company, or you can get several fines even though under the GDPR if you have a data breach. Data breach is kind of a cyber attacks, a cyber breach, then you might get also some GDPR fines, which is very popular right now, and more than 200 fines are already issued, have been issued last year. This is the only one number related to cyber criminality, which will cause the cyber crimes damage will cost to the world economy estimated 5 billion Swiss francs this year and 6 billion Swiss francs by 2021. This huge number, not huge than today we face coronavirus and its effects against the world economy, the cyber criminals are really working day and night to give damage to the world economy. I'm going to share with you one interesting information. This is a digitalization rate of the different sectors, different companies across the world from McKinsey and the company. Here we see that media and communication companies, professional services, and financial and insurance companies are going on digitalization process very fast, and they are going to also implement security measures from the beginning. Unfortunately, we see that governments and healthcare sectors are not that agile. They are still on a traditional way on their process, business process. And of course, cybersecurity is vital, especially for healthcare sector, that we see daily news and articles that cyber attacks happens against the private and state hospitals. As organizations continue to expand their digital footprint, the risk associated with digital business are increasing in a quantitative and a complexity way. And in the same time, we have to provide continuously service to our customers. For that, we need more reliable and more resilient business model. What does it mean, more resilience model? That means that today's organization will never be adequate secure or adequate business resilience if they don't implement enough security measures, if they underestimate or ignore robust cyber security measures. That's very vital for today's digital transformation process. And then you can say that you have competitive advantage in the market once you have implemented cyber security measures in your process. This is the some key project areas on digital transformation process. We see that there are hybrid cloud and their virtualization projects and the customer experience, big data analytics, also digital transformation projects, which will allow the business to have agile and cost-effectively the process. Also, we are creating tomorrow's workplace, mobility, communication, collaboration. In this case, such projects are very complex, costly. In the same time, they create huge risks to business. What we have to do, we have to implement cybersecurity at the beginning, from the first step of the project until the end of the project. And they should always monitor how we will implement all the measures. And we have to manage also those digital transformation key projects. How we will manage them? We will manage them through effective management, process, and technology. Also, human factor is very important at this point. I'm coming to this slide now. Cybersecurity shouldn't remind afterward, but it should be starting point in the projects, as majority of digital transformations activities such as mobility, cloud services, customer experience programs are based on data, system, and the network. And the security of data is the vital for the further going. Too often, the security is seen as a slowing period of the project, that we see that it's not enabling our project, but rather than slowing. But that's not true, because right implementation of the security will help you to be competitive in the market, advantage a company in front of your competitors and the customers. Therefore, we have to always take care of the cybersecurity norms in our company. While we provide outstanding customer experience, personalized programs, agility, and cost-saving procedures. So people, process, technology, those are the main three elements if you want to be successful on your digital transformation journey. People means that we have to have right team and the right experts to help us in our digital transformation period. And the process will escalate, roll out all our policies. You might have right, very good policies, access rights, or password policies, or kind of security policies. Once you don't have any process, all those policies will be useless. Therefore, first you need the experts, security team, and procedure, also technology to enable all your process. Technology is not the important one, but one of the three main elements of your starting point. Cybersecurity breaches or data breaches are different kind of. First of all, I would like not to dive deep on this topic, because it's a topic of another long-term webinar. I would like to give short information what is cybersecurity breaches. They are malicious acts and unintentional acts. Malicious act that cyber criminals are trying to attack your system to gain an access to your mission critical system, network, and data. This is the malicious act, and unintentional act that you have the employee and you don't have a right awareness program, and your employee, they just click on the phishing email or social engineering tools that they face daily in their daily business, and that's unintentional act. Therefore, giving the training, right training, having the right experts on place will be vital for your journey. So once we have malicious act and unintentional act, then we have different four channels for cybersecurity breaches. They are malicious acts from outside, which is caused by cyber criminals, malicious act from inside. I'm sure each company, they have insider, and they just try to gain access to your system to collect as much as possible critical data, in IP data or financial information from your company. So you have to always be careful and have the right access management control, right, have the access monitoring system that who is accessing to your system, who has downloading your data from your system. The next one, unintentional act from outside. That's example, like you have third party service provider and they have weak security system. They don't intend to attack your company, but through their system, cyber criminals can attack your mission critical system. The example is Target case, one of the biggest cyber case in the history in the US, United States, that cyber criminals used third party service providers of Target and attack them, collect millions of financial data and the credit card of the consumers. The last one is unintentional act from inside. This again, our untrained, unknowingly accepted action from our employee that we don't give enough awareness to them, training to them, and they just click the phishing emails, give the credential to the criminals. So using learning system management, learning systems like 15 questions, 10 questions once a year doesn't help anymore. You have to have specific training models, specific awareness programs in the company for different departments and different target groups. That will help you to have less, not zero, but less unintentional act from inside. So successful implementation of your of cybersecurity in your digital transformation projects. What does it mean? That means that today we see a lot of companies, they don't invite security professionals once they decide on strategic projects that they will serve the value of digital transformation to the customers. That means that the role of cyber security professions or data protection professions is more important than before. The companies or organizations, they have to invite the professionals to the same table when they decide on the vital or critical projects. That will help you to implement the security from the beginning. The second one is embedding security measures earlier. As you know, you start from different phases until you deliver your project. Don't call your cybersecurity professional before you launch your project to help you to launch the project next week. That's already late. You have to invite or you have to embed all the security measures from day one until end of your project or program or application launch time. That is the important part of the implementation of cybersecurity in your projects. Here we can use security by design or privacy by design. I would use now right now security by design because it is wide, it has wide meaning than privacy by design. Security by design means that you will implement all the principles of each steps of your projects, each phase of projects. We cannot explain all of them right now because we have a limited time. And privacy by design, it means that when you process the personal data of your customers or partners or employee, you have to always embed or implement all the data protection principles, process of limitation, principle of minimization or confidentiality, integrity or availability. All of them are important to be safe, to be on time and to be advantage, to have an advantage in the market. Therefore, please have the right team, have the right policy and process to be secure in your digital transformation projects. Cybersecurity for your digital transformation process. In digitalization area, some of the world's most sophisticated cybersecurity departments or functions are starting to transform their capabilities along with three important elements. First, you have to use quantitative risk analytics for decision making. That means that at the core of the cybersecurity decisions, and all those decisions mainly made by chief information officer and their business partners. Once they decide for any risk, to have the information risk assessment or catalog, or to see the, what's the risk appetite of the company, they have to always consider the combination of experience, the combination of intuition, judgment, and qualitative analysis. That's important for cybersecurity in digital transformation. The second one is building cybersecurity in the business value chain. What does it mean? That means that leading companies are starting to build cybersecurity in their customer relationship, in their production process, and supply chain interactions. And when they implement those principles in the different departments, they use design thinking to build the security. They use it to educate their customers how interact their applications and programs and the softwares. Also, they treat cybersecurity the core function of the product design. That means that cybersecurity should be always in the center of your production or your product development. The last one is changing traditional security mindset and having cyber culture in your organization. This is the last, but for me, the most important part, because today cyber criminals are highly sophisticated and they don't target your technology. You might invest millions of resources to the technology, but end of the day, your human factor, your employee will be target to the cyber criminals because it's the weakest chain in your company. Therefore, having the cyber culture in the company is a vital. You will do it through the trainings, through the awareness programs, through the one-off online, offline training programs. So how to integrate the cybersecurity? How improve the cybersecurity? According to Gartner's research, by 2020, this year, 60% of the companies will suffer from major service failures because they don't have enough security experts in the company. They don't have enough advice, enough help from the cybersecurity experts. Also in Switzerland, there are over 60,000 there is need for over 60,000 cybersecurity experts right now, and it will always increasing. And we will talk also about this with Daniel Saylor after a couple of minutes. So as I told you, technology is not the important one right now for cyber criminals. Your human factor is the important, because 60% of the breaches are happening because of the human error. And therefore, I would to repeat again that training. It's the important one right now to implement all the security measures in the transformation period. This is the last slides I would like to share with you. This is the cyber risk management strategy from NIST. There are seven different aspects. First aspect is to identify your potential breaches, to know your enemies, who can attack you. What are the potential of them? Then you have to have enough defense in your company. Second, you have to identify your critical system, network, and the data. Where is your data? Who has an access? How many data you store in cloud? How many data you store in local infrastructure? That's important to know. Then you will have the right resource on place. Having the leadership role, cybersecurity leadership role in the company is important. That means that you have to have a department, first line, second line security department in your organization, having privacy department role, and they have to have clear role on the data governance and security governance. Then you will have a little bit technology, of course, throw out your process and policies. Also, you have to always look at the legal implication that there are new laws and the regulations in Switzerland, in European Union, also globally. You have to always have an eye on it. What's going on? What are the new implementation in the current world? Last but not least, you have to have incident response team. You have to have a simulation, incident response simulation, at least once or twice a year. Once the incident happened, you have to know that who is doing what. And the risk mitigation strategy plan is the important one. Every single company, they have to have risk mitigation strategy in their organization. That's all for today. And I would like to invite again Daniel for our interview session. Later on, we will have a Q&A, but feel free to send your question already to Frederica, that she will join us after a couple of minutes. Daniel, thank you very much for being here. You are still there.
Yes, I'm here. Good. Hope you can hear me.
Yes, well, we hear you.
Good.
Daniel, as we know, cybersecurity is not a topic only for small and medium companies. It's also a topic of tech giants and also for governments. Therefore, I would like to know the role of the Swiss governments right now, how they handle the cybersecurity, because it's another level. So you are working in this domain, as we know, and could you give us a brief overview of Switzerland's national cybersecurity strategy?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, that's an obvious question, a very relevant question. I think perhaps to start, let's go a bit back to history. Cybersecurity as a strategy or as a topic of concern is not new. I don't remember exactly when it was first a discussion about a strategy, but it was around 2008, 2009. So you can see it's almost already more than 10 years ago, and this discussion started. And it was not only a discussion, it ended in the first national strategy that was designed for 2012 until 2017. The first strategy, that's important also to know, had the very scope of a bit what you described, how you can protect an organization, a business. And that was also a bit the scope, I would say, to make it really short, how to protect the confederation, the federal confederation. So that was more like an inwards and very focused strategy. So of course, that is not covering the whole reality and the whole world. That is very obvious. It was a good start. However, the version one was then in force, and in parallel to the measures that came with it, there was the works on the version 2, NCS 2.0, let's say. Yeah. And this is in force. It is for 2018 until 2022. So we are more or less in the middle. What I can show you a bit or tell you a bit in this webinar, and I always try to be very to the point, so if you miss any details, please ask. However, the strategic objectives of this strategy was mainly, let's say, seven main focus points, focus elements. There was skills, knowledge, and ability to identify and assess risks, first of all. You need to do a risk assessment also on a state level, but you need to be able to do it. So you need knowledge and skills for that. And of course, then diverse preventive measures that we develop this as a state, that Switzerland can also manage long-standing and cross-sectoral incidents. So not only isolated ones. And of course, that critical infrastructures are resilient to cyber risk and cyber attacks. And of course, the protection of Switzerland against cyber risk is something that is not a task that one organization can do. It's a joint task of society, economy, and the state together. So it's also not the idea that its strategy contains like the protection of each and every individual or company that is still a part of your own responsibility, but it gives the framework on how a state does that. And of course, and we that's certainly a domain I'm working in, is we're committed as a country. So Switzerland's committed to international cooperation to enhance cybersecurity. I think that's an important part. And of course, learning from cyber incidents that happen here, but also abroad, and therefore also international communication and cooperation is important. So that's in a nutshell, perhaps, yeah, it's what is. Yeah.
And so you just explained about the national cybersecurity strategy, and I have read it, and I read several other states' strategy. My question is about the implementation. How you gonna implement it? It will be implemented. Is there any plan or is there any specific measures to roll out all the strategy? Because it's well written, and I would like to know how we will do in the process.
Yeah, that's a very valid question. Perhaps first of all, the strategy is nothing that is a secret. You can download it from the website. It is publicly available, even in English. So in all languages plus English. And not only the strategy, because this is more like describing the ideas and the goals, but also there is an implementation plan. And the implementation plan also available publicly and in English. So you, whoever is interested in it, perhaps we can share it later. This is publicly available. To make it short, the implementation plan has, let's say, 10 areas of action, 10 main topics. I can describe them later if you want. And it splits it into 29 specific concrete measures. So it's like 29 main action points, let's say. And those action points are then again divided into specific sub-measures, let's say, like in a project you have the milestones, and then you have the other points. That's how it is built. And that is, by the way, something that is not just that was just an idea or something. That was actually the Federal Council last May 2019. The Federal Council decided on the implementation plan, and important here, the implementation plan as well as the strategy does not only contain the federal government, it is including the cantons, companies, critical infrastructures, universities.
Thank you very much. So from Swiss perspective, what is needed on international level to ensure cyberspace remain free, secure, and accessible?
Yes, that is a complicated question. let's do it that way. Perhaps a first important thing to be aware of is cybersecurity is not only about technology. I agree with you. You said technology is certainly a part of it, but there's also the human factor, obviously, and there is the international factor, let's say it, because when we talk from a Swiss perspective, it is limited what we can do here. We are a small country and we are very innovative, lot of intelligent people, of course. However, you cannot solve this as a country alone. So it needs international cooperation. International cooperation works a little bit different than you perhaps may be used to it from project work, from how a business works. It takes little steps, and it's progressing sometimes in very baby steps to come to a next part. I think an important aspect is what exactly are the rules that apply in cyberspace. perhaps to you and to the audience, this may sound very obvious or very, down to earth. But in an international level, it is not. It's not so clear what is applicable. I can share you what Switzerland's position is. And of course, we think that is a good position. we think that the international law should apply also on cyberspace, not only in the offline world, but also in the online world, obviously. And also not only the international law as is, but also the international humanitarian law, what means that is applicable during conflicts. And that also should apply to the cyberspace, to activities that are in cyberspace. Of course, that's not so easy to do that. And that's why Switzerland is directly engaged in the United Nations. And there are two processes, it's called. It's like you can see this like two different work streams. One work stream is in a rather small group of 25 countries, the so-called group of governmental experts. And there Switzerland is part. It was invited to join this group. And in this group also it is discussed what is needed to apply, how could we apply offline international law to cyberspace, how to manage that, who will have governance over this, all these questions. But in parallel to that, there is a more wider, let's say, process for more or less the same topics, but there all the UN countries are included. That's the so-called open-ended working group. And there, Switzerland is not only being part of, but Switzerland is the chair of this working group. Mm. So we can, we have a good standing there, and I think it's good as a country to give you our input into this discussion. And
actually, I am a big fan of the United Nations, but recently we see that their decisions are not that powerful in the world. But let's hope that they will have powerful decisions and the law on cybersecurity. Daniel, my last question is about your fans and pretty new job or position, which is cyber foreign policy domain. Can you tell us about this a little bit, that we have last couple of minutes?
Yes, indeed. That's entirely new. So a lot of things are so new that no one did ever anything before in that field. So it means it's quite challenging, of course. Imagine of new technologies. You touched it a little bit in your slides, talking about obvious AI. What is that? Is that a specific topic to cyber? Not exactly. Is it completely different to cyber? Not exactly. Okay. So it means it's something in between. It is in terms of foreign policy. It does also raise some question. How does that influence like the relationship with other countries? What does that mean for economy, and how does that impact the ties we have with other countries, treaties we have? That are rather new question, but also quantum computing, which you perhaps heard that on the EU level there are several activities. Also AI, you saw the EU white paper, but also other things like new technologies, how this is impacting a state as is, but also the state's relationships to other states, which is foreign policy. How does that influence it also in the civil domain, of course, also in the more military and defense domain? How does that change conflict behavior? How does it change diplomacy? We talk about cyber diplomacy. That's what we do. It's also called tech diplomacy sometimes, or science diplomacy, or however you want to name it. It shows that the classical diplomacy now has a strong technology exposure and component. And in order to cover this, it's no longer possible to exclude such topics like for expert level only. it means.
Yeah.
That this is on a state level. You can see it, by the way, even far outside of Switzerland, like the big tech giants like Google, Facebook, Microsoft, they're investing heavily and they even have their own tech ambassadors and they take part in international discussions. That's a new situation. And this needs to be tackled and we are closely monitoring it and we are making sure that the Switzerland's interests are also that they're also defended in such new bodies and topics.
It seems that it's a little bit complex. I wish you all the best and a lot of success in your new role. And now I would like to invite Frederica for the questions from our auditorium that we can both answer.
Thank you, Samir. Thank you, Daniel. We have two questions here. Please send us more or comment. So the first one, in your view, Samir, what role do certifications, for example, ISO 27001X play in the broader context of cybersecurity?
I don't believe that only ISO 27001X certificates will help you to be resilient against cyber criminality because it is just certification and every single day we have new applications, process and the softwares in our companies. Even though you do some updates, then you have new open gate to cyber criminality. It will never help. Therefore, having the right team, expert team, process and procedure will be more successful for you and for your company.
So next one, you talked about the four channels before. Which one is the most critical? And also considering digital transformation, it used to be email, but now there's cloud and SaaS applications.
I would like to say that the external attacks, which is malicious external attacks, are intentional. And there are different motivation from the external attackers like monetary motivation or hacktivist or kind of stuff. Therefore, it's more dangerous than having unintentional and internal attack or insider. Of course, you have to be careful with the insider in your company, not have them or at least detect them, identify them and take them out of your company. But the major security issues are with external threats.
Thank you, Samir.
You're welcome.
What are the implications and possibilities of small and medium-sized companies? Can they even really deal effectively with the issues? And how can they have enough resources, also financially?
Last week, we saw that a medium-sized Swiss company, which is Swiss Windows, they got bankrupt because of cyber attacks. And medium and small-sized companies are more resilient than big giants because you know your system, you know your network. It's easy for you to manage them, to have them all together and giving the right solution all the cyber breaches and defects.
Thank you. That's
You're welcome.
Interesting and somewhat counterintuitive. So
yeah.
Good to hear that. Cybersecurity is also a question of the quality of the software. Are there specific studies on this which show the connection between the quality of the software and cybersecurity?
Actually, Daniel, are you here?
Daniel?
I'm still here, yes. I'm here.
Turn on your video, please.
I think the softwares are more relative to your domain. What would you like to say about this question?
Can you repeat the question? I'm not sure.
I need to find it again. cybersecurity is also a question of how of the quality of the software. Are there specific studies on this which show the connection between the quality of the software and cybersecurity?
Oh, I don't know by heart. Certainly, there are more. That's more in the field of software development, and I'm also developing software, but certainly not the main goal of my job. And I think good practices of software development is certainly the basis of good cybersecurity. It's like privacy by design, it's security by design. And code reviewing practices, quality monitoring, quality assurance processing processes. I think there are is a wide array of possibilities how you can do that. I think that is, there's certainly a point that needs to be taken into account. Yes.
It's also not familiar to me that there's a statistic on the software, but just keep in your mind that malware is everywhere in every single software and applications. Once you buy and or download from any stores, you have to keep in mind that you might also download any kind of malware or another viruses to your target device.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. What do you expect from tech giants? Are they part of the solution or are they part of the problem?
As a university, we stay neutral. That's why.
As a Swiss university, especially.
Yeah. That's why I think I'm not going to answer this question because there are different opinions and views on those questions.
Okay, thank you. Can you make a few remarks on cybersecurity and human rights?
Cybersecurity is relatively related to human rights because end of the day, your data, my data, our data is stolen. It is used for another illegal purposes. And end of the day, our privacy is breached. Our personal data is breached. Our health data, financial data is breached in selling in somewhere in darknet or another places. That's directly related to human rights. And therefore, the role of the states, role of the international organizations is important to have the international law on cybersecurity for our human rights and freedoms.
Here's another one, maybe also for you, Daniel. And do we really have a chance with those traditional measures and political regulations, or should we aim for ecosystems that are immune to cyber threats? How would you immunize a company?
Immunize to threats, you mean?
Yes, if that's even possible.
You should consider all your systems as being hacked right now already. So perhaps that answers your question. No, but it's true. As a matter of fact, you should consider the systems you have in your company or wherever that they are compromised already, and as a baseline. I think to design systems airtight, as we hear it sometimes, certainly is a possibility. It's always depending on your resources. I mean, you can spend a lot of money, and this may or may not give you better solutions to the security. Security is something that is important to know, that is nothing that you install and then it is secure. It means a good assessment of the risks, good assessments of the threat vectors, good assessments of your crown jewels. What is it? What you really need to protect? And then, of course, you need to manage that. You need to make it up to date. You need to have people trained. That's how you do it. I'm not sure if that can be done 100% right and 100% secure.
It's almost impossible.
So, talking about training. If we need to be specific to different departments, can you give examples and other best practices?
An example, I would say that the training should start from board. First, your security department should train the board, have the buy-in. After that, you will start with your C-level department to give them really threat factors. Who are your threat actors right now, the cyber attackers? Then you have to have specific training for your financial department, for your human resources department, also marketing department, until till the production department. You have to have specific trainings on their language that they speak. Therefore, the role of chief information security officer, chief information officer, data protection officer, or compliance officer are very important to design and implement all the specific trainings. One size made trainings will never helpful to your company.
Thank you. So yeah. Here's one last question. If you have another question, please type it now. How there it comes. How can we achieve cybersecurity as long as there are no binding security standards? And there's also a counter argument: have laws ever prevented all crime?
So the cyber criminals are developing themselves day to day. They use most sophisticated technology. Of course, there is no binding rules that we say that, hey, just implement those steps and you will be secure. But also, as I know, that our Swiss government now, they are drafting a new cyber law. Maybe Daniel, you can have some comments on this. Is there any binding rules coming soon for Swiss organizations?
In terms of cybersecurity, I mean, you have the discussion at the moment about a potential regulation, but only for critical infrastructure to report breaches, cyber breaches. Yes, this is in discussion, so it's not much more I can share at the moment.
Thank you.
So, thank you. Thank you for all your questions. Do you have any closing remarks, Daniel and Samia?
I believe that we have another webinar sessions during the week. Please stay tuned and join our another webinars. Also, we have time to time tagungs and another webinars and online events on cybersecurity and data protection. You can always join us free of charge and share your questions and opinions. Thank you very much for watching us.
Thank you also from my side. Thanks for watching. There are 5 more webinars coming this week. If you enjoyed this, why not join more? So have a nice evening.
Thank you very much, Daniel.
Thank you
for having
us. Thank you.